days on end about these past times, so very difficult in one sense to know where to begin, where to end, and especially I've spoken a few times on Lord Ram's appearance day, so as not to repeat what has been said, but at the same time we can hear again and again, so. And of course in the presence of both Murli Manohar Prabhu and Kavi Karnapur Prabhu, who are both deep, profound sadhus, well-versed in Ram Leela. So we'll hopefully hear some interjections from both of them. But to start, I'm going to attempt to sing the Sri Dasa Avatara Stotra by Srila Jayadeva Goswami. And we're going to do it in a way this time so that I'll sing the entire verse all the way through and Rodis will just repeat the Keshava Driyata. Keshava Driyata Mina Shaira, those verses like that. Does that make sense? So not the entire verse, just the Keshava Driyata Mina Shaira. Like that, yeah? Makes sense? Okay.
Palaya payori jale jita vana sivera Dita mitra charita makeda Keshava drita mina sharira Jai jagadisha hare Kara Kamala Vare Nakama Duta Shriyam Dalitai Ranya Kashipu Tanubhya Kesha Madrita Nara Hari Rupa Jai Jagadisha Hare
Alati Bhitti Nindam
Jai Jagadishare, Jai Jagadishare. Jagadish Hare. Jaya Sita Ram Lakshman Hanuman, Jaya Sita Ram Lakshman Hanuman, Jaya Sita Ram Lakshman Hanuman, Jaya Sita Ram Lakshman. Jaya Sita Ram Lakshman Hanuman, Jaya Sita Ram Lakshman Hanuman. Jaya Sita Ram, Sita Ram, Sita Ram. Jaya Sita Ram, Sita Ram, Sita Ram, Jaya Sita Ram.
Just for translation from number 7. So obviously this song is glorifying the 10 specific avatars of the Lord. Anyone can name the first one without looking at the board? Who is the first avatar glorified?
Meena.
Mm-hmm. Meena is Meena Ben? Who comes on Sunday? No. Who's the first avatar glorified in this song? Meena is correct. Meena Sharira? Matsya. Okay. Did you say that already? Okay. Yeah, it's me flower. And the second one?
Korma.
Korma is the? Tortoise, right? In English you say tortoise. Incarnation. Third is? Which incarnation?
Boar,
yes. Varaha, yes. Lord Varaha, they don't look. Don't. Seems to be clever, Nick, that one, yes. And the fourth incarnation? Glorified? Lord Nisringadev, yes. Half man, half animal. So if you get it so far, it goes from fish, tortoise, amphibian, then it goes to boar, which is like mammal, then half man, half lion, Sringa Dave, and then the fifth?
Dwarf,
yes, Brahmana, named? Lord Vamana Dev, yes. And number six? Ooh, now it gets hard. Yes, what did you say? Parashuram, yes. Now it goes into the three Rams. So you have Parashuram, and then number seven is? Lord Ram. Lord Ram Chandra Bhagavan, the king. Ram Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Shri Ram. And number eight? Balaram, yes, Balaram, Lord Balaram, Ki Jai. Number nine? Buddha, yes, Lord Buddha. And number 10 is? Kalki, Kalki Bhagavan Ki. Yeah, so we got it, got them all, okay. So yes, number 7 we'll read. O Keshav, O Lord of the universe, O Lord Hari, who have assumed the form of Ramchandra. All glories to you. In the battle of Lanka, you destroy the 10-headed demon Ravana and distribute his heads as a delightful offering to the presiding deities of the 10 directions headed by Indra. This action was long desired by all of them who were much harassed by this monster. Jai. Death of Ravan Ki.
Jai.
Parents' Day of Lord Ram Ki.
Jai.
Okay, so we will now try to give a little class. Before we do, I would first like to seek blessings from all the assembled Vaishnavas that you see fit to bestow your mercy upon me so that I can speak something relevant and bona fide. About Lord Ram on his auspicious appearance day. Only by the mercy of Vaishnavas is anything possible. So therefore I'm seeking your blessings, and we will first chant the Mangala Acharanam prayers. Om Agnati Nirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurum Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadamayam Vidati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Gurum Shri Yuta Parakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tamsa Jivam Saritam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakam Nitamscha Hare Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopisha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurange Radhe Vrindavanishwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Pancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhye Pacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Srila Prabhupada ki
jaya.
Okay, so today is the auspicious occasion of the appearance of Lord Ram. We have this very beautiful painting here also done. So I thought we could recite two verses. Strangely enough, the two verses I've chosen are not from Bhagavatam, nor are they from, well, at least the first one isn't from the Ramayana, but it's actually from Chaitanya Charitamrita. And I just thought I would repeat it, and we can repeat it once and then read the translations. So this one is... the unembodied voice. Krishna tomara hana yadi bale eke bara.
Krishna tomara hana yadi bale eke
bara. Baya bande haite Krishna tara kare para.
Baya bande haite Krishna tara kare para.
Krishna tomara hana yadi bale eke bara.
Krishna tomara hana yadi bale eke bara.
Haite Krishna Tara Kare Par.
Maya Banda Haite Krishna Tara Kare Par.
Krishna, sorry. Krishna Tomara Haya Yara Bale Ke Bar.
Krishna Tomara Yara Bale Ke Bar.
Maya Banda Haite Krishna Tara Kare Par.
Maya Banda Haite Krishna Tara Kare Par.
Anyone is familiar with this verse at all? So this is being spoken, 22, Madhya Leela.
Yeah.
Who's, yeah, I mean, yeah.
Who teaches Rupa Goswami?
I think it's Sanatan Goswami, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Lord Chaitanya is speaking to Sanatan Goswami, pretty sure. And he says, one is immediately freed from the clutches of Maya if he seriously and sincerely says, my dear Lord, we can all say this together, my dear Lord, although I have forgotten you for so many long years in the material world, today I am surrendering unto you. I am your sincere and serious servant. Please engage me in your service. Someone is immediate, so you've all just become immediately freed from the clutches of Maya. Haribo! So, class over, finished, done. Maybe we can read it again, yeah? Just that part. It's, we should all read and recite and say and think and feel, and we can maybe look towards their lordships and pronounce this to them with deep feeling within our heart. My dear Lord,
although I have forgotten you,
for so many long years, in this material world, today,
I am surrendering unto you.
I am your sincere
and serious servant.
Please engage me in your service. So then the next verse, text 34 of the same chapter. This one is in more Bhagavad Gita meter. Sakre deva prapano yas.
Sakre deva prapano yas.
Tavasmiti chayachate.
Tavasmiti chayachate.
Abhayam sarvadatasmai.
Abhayam sarvadatasmai.
Vidami etad vratam mama.
Vidami etad vratam mama.
Sakre deva prapano yas.
Sakre deva prapano yas.
Tavasmiti chayachate.
Tavasmiti chayachate.
Abhayam sarvadatasmai.
Abhayam sarvadatasmai.
Idami etad vratam mama.
Idami etad vratam mama.
Sakrideva prapanoya.
Sakrideva prapanoya.
Tamasmiti chayachate.
Tamasmiti chayachate.
Abhayam sarvada tasmai.
Abhayam sarvada tasmai.
Idami etad vratam mama.
Idami etad vratam mama.
So this verse is from the Ramayana. It is my vow, please repeat, it is my vow,
it is my vow
that if one only,
if one only
once seriously surrenders
unto me,
saying,
my dear Lord,
from this day,
I am yours,
and praise to me. For courage,
I shall immediately
award courage
to that person,
and he will always,
remain safe
from that time on. Nice verses, huh? Very powerful. So this is spoken by Lord Ram at a very climactic part. Let's read that again because I think it's so wonderful. We can keep reading it for the whole class, especially at the moment. I think Murlipu is probably reading for the third time his Guru Maharaj's books on Kalpakamudi, but this power of vows and pronouncing our intention of what we want to do, how we want to approach the Lord, the mood that we want to approach the Lord, the spirit that we want to approach the Lord, and how we want to engage in devotional service, where we want to aspire to go to, what is our goal? What is our goal? Because it's very easy to get caught up in one place, or as they say, you can have your wheels stuck in the mud, just spinning around. Think you're going nowhere, but you're actually, think you're going somewhere, but you're actually going nowhere, very fast. Or like the pastime Prabhupada tells of the wedding party. Everyone knows the wedding party that gets in the boat, and they get in the boat and they're planning to go off for the program, and they row all night long, and the boatsman is rowing, and in the morning they wake up and they're still stuck in the same place because
the shame.
Yes, the anchor. Yeah, the string. Did you say string?
Chain.
Yes, the chain. Well, the anchor was still like stuck in, so they were doing lots of hard work, but actually going
nowhere.
So we have to be clear about where we're going and be putting in the effort and endeavor to get there. Otherwise, you get really stuck like that. Hare Krishna. Anyone here feel stuck, or is everyone moving? Who feels stuck? Who feels like they're moving? Okay. Well, seems like some serious challenges there. So let us read this verse again, spoken by Lord Ram. It is my vow. So this is the vow of who? No. This is the vow of Lord Ram. So this is God speaking. This is his vow. And who's he making this vow to? To his devotees. To basically anyone who surrenders to him. So he says, it is my vow. That if one only once,
seriously surrenders unto me,
saying,
My dear Lord,
from this day,
I am yours,
and praise to me,
for courage,
I shall immediately award courage
to that person,
and he will always
remain safe
from that time on. Of course, the challenge is that sometimes we hear a verse like this and we think, well, that was good, I said it, right? So it says I only have to say it once. Hopefully we just said it with a bit of seriousness and sincerity, and then we think I need never say it again. Like I remember once when I was reading through the sixth canto of the Bhagavatam, and of course the pastime of Ajamil, And in those purports, Srila Prabhupada speaks so amazingly about the holy name, the power of the holy name, and there's a point at which Prabhupada says, if one has even at least once chanted the holy name purely, then he's a liberated soul. He's free from all karmic reactions and material distresses. And I remember I was chanting, walking around Soho Square, thinking, I must have chanted at least one pure name by now. And it's interesting, the mentality, the consciousness that seeps in, because you start to think, well, you know, so now I don't have to really try anymore, you know, I don't have to do anything. I can just muck about and it doesn't really matter. Anyone else has a tendency for that kind of mentality to get a little lazy or lethargic and we think, I've done enough. Maybe I've done enough. Maybe that's it. You know, I know it. His Holiness Satchinanda Maharaj, when he gives this amazing japa workshops, and one of them he was talking about the entry into the holy name and how there are four gates. Anyone's heard this before? The four gates to the pure holy name? Yes? Really? No, I'm sure I told it before. Anyway, says he explains that the first gate, he says the first three gates we have keys to. We can actually unlock the doors. Yes, so that's important because it means we actually have the capacity to make sure that those doors get open. So he says the first door is actually, what is it? The first door is the bodily platform. So he says, so like Prabhupada says, sit properly. So he says, so you have to sit properly when you chant. You have to sit up straight. You know, you can't be like laying down. You know, anyone has that lazy tendency. Sometimes you chant, maybe lay back a little bit, relax. So he says, no, you have to sit properly. He said, the second gate is the mind. And Prabhupada says that we have to chant the holy name so that it's just simply a conversation between the tongue and the ear. And the mind should become captivated by the sound vibration of the holy name. And so we chant like that, and that opens the second gate. And the third gate is the heart, the emotion. So we actually have to chant with love. We have to chant, calling out like a child cries for its mother, longing for Krishna, feeling separation. And then the third gate opens, and that brings us to the fourth gate. And he says, the fourth and final gate behind which is standing Shishi Radha Nandanishwara, Radha Krishna in their pure form, in the pure manifestation of the holy name, just waiting to give us darshan. But the only thing that we can do outside that gate is keep chanting. And he says, it's up to them when they decide to open that gate. There's not anything we can do to make them open that gate, except sincerely sit and keep chanting with attention, focus, and with a heart that is focused on trying to offer them our love, our life, so like that. Anyhow, so yes, this verse is spoken in the Ramayana. And anyone has any reflections, any feedback at this point so far? Anything? Questions? Comments? Yes, Kathy. Might not be on.
Hare Krishna. Yeah, I'd like an example of like what you're saying about taking the rounds for chanting, you know, for granted and so forth. Because I was on my way back from the office and I realized that I forgot my beads, so I started walking back. And then I realized I had my bead bag on my hand, and I was like, Hare Krishna.
It's
so embarrassing. I'm surprised
I'm
even telling you.
It's a wonderful example. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. I forgot my bead band. Wait, oh, there it is. Yeah, it's good. Yeah, we can just take it for granted. Be so not present while we're chanting. I'm sure everyone has some experience of that. So, this verse is spoken by Lord Ram. And Murali Manohar Guru kind of gave away a little bit who he spoke to. Who did he speak it to?
Vibhishan.
Vibhishan, yes. And who is Vibhishan?
Ram's brother.
Ravana's brother. Okay, Ravana's brother. Yes, so Vibhishan is the brother of Ravana. And there's a point at which Vibhishan, he comes to present himself to Lord Ram. And this comes after quite a heavy dialogue in Lanka. And this dialogue, there was a meeting with Ravan and all of his generals and family members to discuss, whether he should actually formally and officially declare war against Ram. Now this is after Hanuman has already come and he's basically burned down Lanka. So Ravan is furious and he's having this conversation amongst his advisors and his military people. And he's saying, we should go to war, we should kill Ram, because, you know, he has no idea how furious I can be in battle, how I can unleash so much and, you know, kill so many. He said, and he's nothing but a pathetic human. And of course, we have to remember that Ravan has a benediction that he can't be killed more or less by anyone. But he left out one group of people. And what was that group of people that he left out?
Humans,
because he thought humans are just, you know, pathetic, little, imbecile, useless creatures. What can they ever do to me? Right? What can they ever do to me? So he left them out. Who did he get this benediction from? We have a discrepancy amongst the sages. Who was it? You said who? Lord Brahma. Someone else said another name.
Lord Shiva.
Lord Shiva. Mm-hmm. So who thanks Lord Brahma? Who thanks Lord Shiva? Not even the person who said it would raise his hand. Who's not thinking, really? Huh? Who thinks someone else? Lord Indra. Who thinks Indra? Not sure. Who's not sure? Who would like to know? Raise both hands and say, Hari Bol. So yes, Gavikarnapur Puru was correct. It is Lord Brahma. Yes. So Lord. Say it again. Ravana's great-grandfather, yes. His great-grandfather, yes. So yeah, actually he was performing austerity in order to get these boons, and he got to the point because Brahma wasn't coming. And then eventually he started to
saw off his different apertures.
Yeah, he started hacking off his own arms, offering them into the fire. And then still Brahma wasn't coming, so then he started
sawing off his appendages,
hacking off his heads, because he had 10 heads, so he started hacking his heads off and lobbing them into the fire to get the attention of Lord Brahma. This is austerity in the mode of
ignorance.
Dark ignorance, yes. So and then Lord Brahma came and gave him this benediction. But he neglected to request that he couldn't be killed by humans. So he's making fun of Lord Ram, because Lord Ram is a human. And not only is he a human, so he's with his brother Lakshman. So there are two humans, and then the rest of his army are a bunch of monkeys. So this human and his brother and you know, what are they? They're like rejects, right? They're rejects. They've been rejected from their
tribes.
From their tribe, from their community. They've been rejected, right? They're ousted. They're banished to the forest. So some reject humans with a group of monkeys And they think somehow they're going to take me, destroy me. So he's giving his speech to rile up his
2 million monkeys.
2 million. It was a lot of monkeys there. It's a lot of monkeys. But everyone was like, yes, Robin, yes. Except for one person. One person decided to speak out against Robin.
His brother?
His brother, Vibhishan. And Vibhishan basically said, Robin, this is just not a good idea. I know everyone here is cheering you on and trying to encourage you, but I want you to know that I'm actually your friend. And I tried to warn you when you brought Sita here that this was going to be a problem, but you didn't listen then, and now you can see what's happening. So my request to you is please, please don't do this. Don't do this. Just give Sita back. And everything will be resolved. And we can carry on. But if you proceed in this way, we're all going to be the losers. What do you think Robin said? Yeah. How dare you! Insult my intelligence. How dare you stand against me? So I'm just trying to keep Tabby Drew awake. I think that one worked. Oh, I want to go to this other thing. You're awake, Tabby Drew? Yeah. Yes, actually, there's a good verse. I have it on the screen here, but somehow you can't get to it when you're in this. Let me see.
It was like oil thrown on the fire of his rage.
Thank you.
Words of Vibhishan.
It was like oil thrown on the fire of his rage. Oh, where is it?
But Vibhishan, he actually argued, he said, like, you come to us now for advice after you've kidnapped Sita. Mm-hmm. You should have come before you did that. But now you come and you want us to have saved you.
Yeah, so, and this is a very good point, that sometimes we only ask for advice or guidance when it seems like it's more or less too late. Sorry, I had this thing here. I really wanted to read. I thought I had it.
But it's easier to ask for forgiveness.
Easier to ask for forgiveness than permission. Oh, no, I can't find it.
I mean, this is a Vedic principle. We can apply this. This is a Vedic principle that we can apply to a temple.
Maybe you could use the mic.
Sibilance.
Is it working?
Sibilance. Sibilance.
Yeah, so to ask for forgiveness rather than permission. So is this like a principle that we can use like in everyday temple life?
Say that again.
Is it a principle that we can use in everyday temple life? No. Or we just ask for forgiveness rather than permission?
I'm just wondering because it's there.
I get distracted for one moment and it all goes to the cappy world. Okay, I'm coming back.
Rise up.
All right. So your question is it a principle that we just ask for forgiveness instead of permission? What do you think? Is it a Vedic principle?
I don't know. That's why I'm asking a question.
Okay. Anyone else would like to answer? What do you think? Well, what do you think, sadhus, or assembly of Vaishnavas?
I know it sounds like some type of trick question, but it sounds like the obvious. Obviously, you used to ask permission.
Of course.
Is there some trick question? Is it?
I don't think it's a trick question. It didn't seem to be.
Why is it a question?
Why is it a question? Yeah. I mean, obviously we should approach and ask permission, and then if someone says no, then of course we should do it anyway and ask for forgiveness later, right? Yeah. Right? So, can we... Of course not. Of course, I mean, otherwise, why would you seek permission? But, you know, what happens is, like, even amongst kids, you know, there's mommy and daddy, right? And usually if dad will give you a yes answer on a certain thing, then you'll go and ask dad, right? Or if you think mom might give me the yes answer on this one, then you'll go and ask mom. And so, you know, our mentality is a little bit often, you know, polluted by this lust, desire to enjoy and get what we want, instead of taking shelter of those who are, whatever, our seniors that we may have to ask permission from, whoever that may be, and listen and try to hear from them in such a way that if there is some way that we can improve and grow. Otherwise, what's the point? Right? What's the point? Tadviri prani patena pri prishnena sevya upadet shanti teganam gyaninas tattva darshana. We have to inquire submissively. If we...
Permission means blessings.
Yeah, exactly. Perfect. Yes. Permission means blessings. So...
It's Rakshasa Dharma to steal other people's wives, you know. It's like one of the four unmentionable types of marriage, you know, that you want to kick down the door and drag them out by the hair or whatnot. That's what Rakshasa do, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So why was he in trouble?
Because he stole the wife of the wrong person. That's why he was in trouble. So you can follow your Rakshasa Dharma, but when the Lord of Dharma, when the king, the ambassador of Dharma, all Dharma, when you take his wife and he comes knocking at your door, then he's going to teach you about real Dharma. So anyway, I can't find this statement, but basically Ravan just, he insults Vibhishan and basically says to him, you're like a venomous snake here in this assembly, speaking against me. You're supposed to be my brother, but you're just, you know, basically you're filth, you're scum, and why are you even speaking like this? And so Vibhishan's like, okay. And Indrajit, who is the son of Ravan, he basically starts saying, you know, how are you're supposed to be my uncle, you're supposed to be a Rakshasa, you're not even acting properly. You know, so they all basically deride him. And so Vibhishan leaves. Interesting, because there's a bit of a correlation between Mahabharata, right? Who was another uncle that tried to speak to a person in control. Yeah. Uncle Vidura, he was trying to speak to Dhritarashtra. Speak some sense. Hey, what are you doing? And he wouldn't listen. He just wouldn't hear, because this is what happens. So Ravan is overcome, blinded by lust, and becomes so proud that he can't hear anything. Can't hear anything. So it just falls on what they call deaf ears. So so this is the point that basically... Oh, here it is. Duh, I copied it over. Yeah, he says, Ravan says, it is better to live with an enraged serpent than a person who, although pretending to be a friend, is actually in league with the enemy. It is a fact that kinsfolk usually despise their chief, even though he may be carrying out all his duties. The greatest danger lies in one's own relatives. This is Ravan speaking. Oh, disgrace of our race, for they may turn on one at any time. Although a brother, you are unworthy of my affection. Indeed, one bestowing love upon the unworthy obtains only grief. So this is what Ravan said to Vibhishan. basically just your sad case. You're not acting proper. And he gives, you know, he espouses such philosophy. And this is also the thing, that we can espouse so much philosophy, you know, when we don't want to hear. Or when someone speaks something to us that we may think they're attacking us, but actually they're probably speaking the truth. It's just our false ego cannot stand to hear it. Because the false ego is this interesting creature that just often blocks out some of the most valuable information for our lives, you know, just because it's trying to protect that false sense of who we are, our false sense of identity. So basically Robin just says, away with you, out of my sight. And that's when Vibhishan leaves. And he decides this is it. He's done for. And actually, I'm not gonna contribute to this anymore. And so he goes with, I think, five other Rakshasas, and they all go to where Lord Ram is, in this picture here, on the other side, on this India side. I guess they're at Rameshwaram, right? That's where they built the bridge from Rameshwaram. Anyone's ever been to Rameshwaram? I was very lucky to go there many years ago. It's this long, long stretch of beach that goes out into the sea. And this is where Lord Ram basically began building the bridge. So Vibhishan goes there and he basically says, I've come to surrender myself to Lord Ram. I'm the brother. I'm a Rakshasa. I'm the brother of Ravan. My name is Vibhishan. Please allow me to surrender. So, interestingly enough, Sugriv, he immediately runs to Lord Ram, and he says, oh no, we're in big trouble, basically. This Rakshasa has come with five other Rakshasas, and they're trying to play a trick on us. They've actually come. He says he's going to surrender, but he's a Rakshasa. And Rakshasas can't change their nature. And then some of the other persons present, Lakshman was also there, and some of the other monkeys. And they all began giving their input. Or Lord Ram listened to Sugriv for some time, and he was thinking to himself. And then he opened it up and he asked, anyone else? Anyone else has any input? And others were agreeing with Sugriva and saying that basically we're worried. He's come here. It's a trick. You have to be careful. This is a trick. And if we let him in, then he can do anything. And once he finds out our plans and knows our military strategy, or he could just start killing us off one by one. So they were all very concerned. And Ram was listening. Genuinely listening and hearing from them. This is also really important compared to the scene before, but he was listening to the devotees around. And then he asked, because Hanuman hadn't spoken, because Hanuman is, although he's one of the greatest, you know, servant of Lord Ram, and also one of the greatest in the monkey army, but he's also very humble, so he was just, you know, not saying anything. And Ram said, Hanuman, what do you think? And he said, well, it's not proper for me to instruct you because you are Lord Ram. You are our leader. You're like the greatest personality, and I'm simply surrendered to you. But if you're asking me my opinion, then I will give it. And so he does. And he says, I did not detect any deceit when he spoke. He said, sometimes when someone is trying to manipulate, you can detect. He said, and when he spoke, I didn't detect this. And I think that actually, he's sincere. And I think that he's come here to basically surrender. And if he joins our army, then he has so much information about Ravan. So it will be beneficial for us. And so Lord Ram thought for a moment. He conjugated amongst, and he started to think, and then he spoke. And that's when he spoke this verse. And Lord Ram said, basically, He said, I can't reject anyone who comes to surrender to me. It's impossible. I just can't do it because this is my vow. That anyone who comes to surrender unto me, then I will give them protection. And then he says, even if Ravan comes, even if Ravana comes here now and he surrenders to me, I will accept him because I can't reject anyone who surrenders to me. And so he speaks this very powerful verse. And Sugriva and all the monkeys, they're just like, of course, you're Lord Ram. Jai Ram, Jai Ram, Jashi Ram. So then they all agreed with him and they settled. So it's interesting the way that Lord Ram dealt with the matter. He also took advice. He was surrounded by advisors, but he was a bit more receptive. He didn't really just want yes men. But in the end, he also made the decision. But he also validated and explained why he was making that decision. But he also said, anyway, these are only 5 Rakshasas. I could kill them all like that. So even if we let them in and they turn out to be mischievous or, you know, duplicious, then anyway, I can just get rid of them, no problem. So everyone felt safe. And of course, then Lord Ram let them in. So there are different ways of getting advice and taking advice. Everyone still with me so far? Yeah? Anyone bored, senseless just yet? Starting to get close? Okay. So this principle of good advice, it seems that throughout Ravan's journey, he was perpetually getting some good advice that he couldn't take and couldn't accept. So there was another time that he was given good advice by, anyone knows another person who gave him some good advice? Palasya. Okay, that's not who I was thinking about.
The sage who disguised himself as the deer.
Yes, and his name is? Anyone knows the name of the sage who disguised himself as a deer? I can hear the devotees at home going, Yeah.
Nope.
Marichi. Yes, Maricha. But Marichi is the other. But Maricha. So when the whole thing started, because actually, of course, the whole pastime of the Ramayan starts with, well, where does it start? We could go on for ages where it starts, but you know, it starts with, let's say, Lord Ram, Kaikeyi, and Mantara speaking to Kaikeyi because Bharat is not going to be made the king. Lord Ram is going to be made the king. So Mantara, the hunchback maidservant of Kaikeyi, she starts to give her wicked association by saying, oh, this is terrible for you. This is terrible. You know, if Bharat doesn't become the king, you'll no longer be the favored queen. And then, you know, then you'll be treated like nothing. And she just keeps talking and talking, gossip, nasty stuff, just speaking all rubbish. It's like this, you know, people that speak so much rubbish. And then we become convinced by the rubbish. So she's speaking like this, and then Kaikeyi becomes turned, and she asks Dasharatha for the 2 boons, the 2 benedictions. First benediction, make my son Bharat the king. And second benediction is you should banish Ram to the forest for 14 years. 14 years. I always get those confused because the Pandavas were for 12 years. Or was it the other way? Is it? Anyone knows for sure? 14 years, Sita Ram banished? It was 14 years, yeah. But the Pandavas was only 12, I think. So like that, then they get banished, and then of course they go to the forest, and Sita says, oh no, Ram, if you leave, I have to come with you. And Ram says, no, you must stay back. I can't have you coming to the forest. You're a princess. How can you go into the forest? Because you'll have to wear tree bark. Tree bark. Yeah, tree bark. Who wants to wear tree bark? Nobody. Maybe you can imagine. Do you think scabies is bad? You know, put some tree bark on. So yeah, who wants to wear tree bark? And he says no, but she says no, Ram. If you go to the forest and leave Ayodhya, then I will be in hell because Ayodhya will become like hell. But if I'm with you in the forest, then even hell in the forest will become like heaven. Like what? Ayodhya, yes, Ayodhya. Yes, so this is a good wife, you can say, right? My wife, come to the forest, yes? Put on tree bark? Heck no. Okay, so anyway, I gotta try. So anyway, like that. So they're in the forest, and so many things happen going into the forest, and Bharat comes, but then they carry on, and there's a point in the forest where someone approaches them, another individual, a lady, a Rakshashi lady. Sounds like a generic song, right? Rakshashi lady. No. Who is it? Rakshashi. Who is it? Shuparnika, yes. Shurparnika. Huh?
Shupanaka.
What does it mean?
One who has nails like a shuka. Naka is like nails and shuka. Which Bridgeville explain what a shuka is. Yeah. Yeah, the shuka, yeah.
A kind of big bowl where you take the husk out of rice.
Oh, okay, one of those.
Oh, yeah. Like that. The shoe's so big, her nails are compared to the shuka, you know, such as.
Shurparnika. Okay, so she has long nails. Doesn't speak much about her nails, but she's not a pretty hideous looking being. But she has the ability to transform herself, as many Rakshashis do. They can make themselves look very attractive. But as she was going through the forest, she saw Lord Ram, and from a distance she thought, ooh, look at a handsome man. How lovely, look at him. And so she didn't transform herself. She just immediately walked up so enamored because she was completely driven by this lust, this desire to enjoy Lord Ram. So she approached Lord Ram and she offered herself, you know? You're such a handsome man here in the forest, and you can see I'm beautiful, beautiful lady. Why don't we enjoy together? We can be together. What did Lord Ram say? Sure, no problem. Meet me in the hut in about 10 minutes. And, no? He said... No, he was actually quite polite. He said, no, you are definitely, definitely a most magnificently beautiful lady. Oh, I don't think I've ever seen a lady as beautiful as you. Lakshman was standing nearby. Lakshman kind of picked up on his sarcastic mood. And he said, but I am a taken man. I have my wife here, Sita. So I'm with her. But... if you really want a handsome man, strong, valiant, warrior type, then here's my brother, Lakshman. And I'm sure he's available. He's free. He has no one. You can easily be with him. But I have taken Ekpatni Vrat. I have declared I'll only have one wife. But you can go with Lakshman. So she went to Lakshman. Because that's the way it is, you know, when you're really lusty, it's like, yeah, whatever. Anything will do. Move on to the next person. And so she goes to Lakshman, and Lakshman says, oh, yes, you are a very, very beautiful lady, but, you know, unfortunately, you know, if I'm simply the servant of Lord Ram and the servant of Sita. So if you join with me, then you'll spend your whole life being nothing but a dasi. Being a dasi of of Sita, even becoming a servant of the servant. So do you want to be a dasi or do you want to be a rani? Do you want to be the queen or do you want to be a servant? Of course you want to be the queen, so it's better you go with Lord Ram. So then she started to feel a little, what are these guys doing with me here? And so she realized she really wanted Lord Ram. She went back to Lord Ram and she began to approach Lord Ram. And then she saw Sita. And she became so envious and furious with Sita that she decided that actually she's the reason why I can't have the object of my desires, the object of my lusted desires. So now let me destroy her. Let me annihilate her. So she got out her, what were they called? Shupa? Her shoops. Her shoop nails. Like Freddy Krueger. Pulled it back and she was ready to launch into Sita. And then what happened?
Lakshman intervened.
Yes. Ram said, enough of this! Lakshman? And what did Lakshman do? He got out a fingernail file and started what did Lakshman do?
Plastic
surgery, yeah. He said, time for some cosmetic surgery. And he pulled his sword out. And what did he do? He removed some...
bit of the nose.
Huh?
A bit of the nose.
A bit of the nose. He just took a little bit off the nose, please. Because she had a big, long nose like this. So he immediately went... off her nose, and then her nose went on to the other side of the Godavari, because they were camped next to the Godavari River. And where it landed on the other side, anyone knows what that place is called? Nasik. Nasik, because in Sanskrit, nose is Nasik, I think. So Nasik. So where it landed on the other side. And then anything else he chopped off? Yes, her ears also. I don't know where they landed, but they didn't say. It's also lopped off her ears. So then, this is what you see here. Well, that's just before the cosmetic surgery. So she became inflamed and started screaming. Should I scream? How do you think she would scream? Anyone would like to scream like she would scream? Mother Rebecca? Go on. You played a witch in one movie. I remember. I saw it a long time ago. Good. Go ahead. Give it to us. Just belt it out. How would she scream? No? Anyone? Rupa? You're an actor. That was pretty good. Anyone else? Anyone else can better that? Yeah, so she began to scream like mad. You had your chance, Mother Rebecca, come on. So yeah, so she screamed and then she ran off. And she ran off and she found her brother. Well, it says brother, but I think it's her cousin brother, Kara. Right? Kara, who was a huge, huge Rakshasa who was residing in that forest. And he ran away and found Kara. This is Kara.
Yeah.
So this is what the Rakshasas look like. This be Ram. This be Kara. and I think his name is Dusha. Dusha, right? Dushan, yeah, Dushan. This is his general. So Sarpanika ran over to him and said, screaming, ah, look what they've done. And he was like, oh my God, what's happened to you? Who's done this to you? And she said, these two humans over there, Ram and Lakshman, and they have this woman, Sita, and they did this to me. And Kara says, I'll kill them. And he immediately sends, I think, like 14 Rakshashas to go and kill. And Sarpanika went with him because she just wanted to see basically she was going to convince him to just kill Sita so she could still get Ram, but it didn't quite work out. And when they got there, Ram just unleashed his arrows and just killed them all, no problem. And so she ran back to Kara and she said, this is, you know, you have to go again. And he's sitting on his throne enjoying, and he's like, I just sent 14. She said, they're all dead. And then he said, what? How could a mere human? She said, he's like no normal human. He's not your average human. This is his very special personality. And so he took his entire army and he went, and then he showed up, and Lord Ram sent Sita into a cave and told Lakshman to guard her, and then he did battle with Kara and basically defeated him and killed him. Somehow Sharpanika, she also escaped again, as did another person whose name was Akampana. And so Akampana, he went back, he ran away, and he went back to Lanka, and he told, everyone still with me on the storyline here? It's a lot of names, a lot of faces. So he went back to Ravan, and he said to Ravan, he said, you know, I bring you news, and it's not good news. And evidently Ravan had a bit of a reputation. I think it's where the, don't, you know, what is it, don't shoot the messenger? Yeah. So that if you bring a bad message to Ravan, then it might not end so good for you. So he came to Ravan and he said, I have a message, I have a message. The most horrendous thing has happened. Kara has been killed. Dushan has been killed. And in the forest there's these two humans. So this is the first time that Ravan is hearing about Lord Ram. So this is his first exposure to Lord Ram, and thinking, oh, okay, or understanding, okay, so this person is here, and yes, so it's just some human, so how did he kill these Rakshashas? And so he, of course, Akampana, he explains also he's accompanied by this very beautiful woman. So everybody knew that Ravan was very, very lusty guy. So if they wanted to manipulate him in any way, they would just, you know, Akampana thought, yeah, basically you should go and avenge Kara, but, you know, the best way to do that is you should go and you should steal Sita from Ram. So he tries to convince him of this plan. So he presents the whole plan to him and starts to describe Sita and how beautiful she is and how she's more beautiful than any of the queens you have here in your palace. And actually, she's more beautiful. If you combine them all together, she's more beautiful than all of them. So Robin's like, really? Okay. So then he thinks, okay, I have an idea. And he goes to Marich. And when he goes to Marich, he asks him, so what do you think? Marich, what do you think? Shall we go? I have this plan. You can act like a deer and distract Ram. And while Ram is distracted, then I can take Sita. So what did Marich say?
What enemy have you been taking counsel from?
Very good, yes. Whoever gave you this idea is not your friend. He is simply your enemy, and he wishes to see you
dead.
Ravan was taken back. What do you mean? And he said, oh, I've done battle with this Ram. He said, that's why I'm here in the Himalayas performing austerities, because we were ruling over this forest area where the rishis were situated, and we used to go and, you know, eat them and destroy their sacrifices. And then who was it? What was the person who came?
Vishwamitra.
It wasn't Vishwamitra. It was
Tathagata. Swami Marich Tathagata. The three demons.
No, the other V. Not Vishwamitra.
Vishishta.
Vishishta, yes, I think. Wasn't it? Vishishta
was the priest of Dasarath. Vishwamitra was the one who was living in the forest.
Oh, he was the one that. Okay. Okay. So yeah, so Vishwamrita was there, and he said, and Ram came, and he was just a little boy. And I thought, who's this little boy? He said, and then he basically killed all of us. But I managed to escape, so I ran away. He said, and then we were in someplace else, and we were dressed up like, oh, and I forget the name, some, we were, because they can take different shapes, and they had taken the shape of this, what is it? It's like a half lion and half bird. I think in Greek mythology, it's like a griffin. I think it's called a griffin or something like that. But it's a form of this ferocious animal that can fly, but it's like a lion. And he said that we were performing, we were killing different rishis again in a different area, and we bumped into Ram, and he basically killed everyone again. He said, so that's it. It's a clear sign for me. I'm not having anything to do with Ram. Now I'm here performing austerities and penances until I die, and that's it. He said, so Robin, don't do this. Give it up. And actually, Robin listened. He thought, okay. So the first time he listened, and he went away. He went back to his kingdom, and he just thought, anyway, so be it. But then in comes Shurparnakha. And she's got her face still full of blood, dried up, no nose, no ears. And she starts wailing. Ah! Ravan, just look what they've done to me. And so, again, he's not so interested in, you know, defending her honor, but as soon as she starts to say, talk about Sita, again, he becomes very interested. He's like, ooh, now all of a sudden, his ears perk up. He starts saying, yes, I've heard about this Ram, and I've heard about this Sita. And so she really starts to go on, and she basically says, I was there in the forest, and I was trying to get Sita for you. That's what I was trying to do when they attacked me. I was trying to get Sita for you, and then they attacked me. So you should go and you should kidnap this Sita. And Ravan becomes overwhelmed. It ignites the lust in his heart even more. So he decides, he goes back to Marich. And Marich is like deep in meditation. And then Ravan comes in and he's like, yes, Ravan, well, you're back. Why are you back? What, is everything okay? Is everyone all right? And he said, yes, I've changed my mind. We're going to the forest and you're coming with me. You're going to be a deer. He says, oh, Ravan, please. I don't want to go there. I don't want to do this. And tries to convince him. But Ravan says, you have two choices. Either you can come with me, and possibly if things go wrong, you'll be killed by Ram. Or if you don't come with me, then I'll kill you myself right here. So what's your choice? You got 2 minutes. And so Marich described, he began to think, well, it's probably, well, the way it's described is, it was better to be killed by the enemy of the king rather than to be killed, executed by the king himself directly. But other places it's also described that he thought better to be killed by Lord Ram, because then there's actually some hope of benediction for me. So he went to the forest. Everyone's still awake, still with me. Went to the forest. And of course, that's the famous pastime with the golden deer. So Marich becomes this beautiful golden deer. And Sita is very attracted to the deer. And she says, oh, Ram, look at this beautiful deer. It's so nice. Please, catch it for me. I want that deer. And Ram's like, yes, my dear, whatever you want. And so he tells Lakshman to stay and look after Sita. And that's the scene where Lakshman is accused of wanting to enjoy with Sita, because when Ram is chasing Marich the deer through the forest, then he finally pulls his arrow out and he shoots. And right as the arrow penetrates Marich, and the voice identical to Lord Ram's calls out, Sita, Sita, Lakshman, Sita. And then he dies. And they hear it. And Sita says, oh no, Ram is in trouble. Lakshman, you should go and help him. And Lakshman says, Ram's not in trouble. Ram can take care of himself. Don't you remember, he just like killed all those chashes. He can handle himself. It was a little deer. No problem. And she's like, no, didn't you hear? He's in trouble. Why don't you go and help him? She said, because he told me to stay here and protect you. She said, no, I understand your mind. You want to stay here to enjoy with me. Lakshman was like overwhelmed. Yeah, words can be so cutting. And so he went into the forest to find Ram. And then that was when Ravan came as
a mendicant,
yeah, dressed as a sadhu. Dressed as a sadhu with his kamandalu and, you know, his bit of top cloth and
on his lips are Sanskrit mantras, and in his heart, the blackest evil.
Okay, so I'll try to thank you, that was a very important point. Yes, yeah, so on his lips were Sanskrit mantras, but in his heart was the blackest of evil. Yeah, is that right? Like that? Almost. I have to work on it to practice. Yeah, so he was very wicked. Wicked, not in the cool term, wicked. Yeah, he was wicked, but wicked, like literally, he was dark, evil. And so he began speaking to Sita. Oh, my dear, noble lady, what are you doing here in this forest?
Before the
Lakshman,
he protected
the... Yeah, the Lakshman Rekha. The old Lakshman Rekha. That's a debatable one. Evidently in the Valmiki Ramayana, the Lakshman Rekha is not there, my understanding.
Is there a supplementary, like Koma Purana speaks about the whole Maya Sita thing, that
wall of fire, but I haven't read. Yeah. It's a debatable thing. That's why I often leave it out. But it's always spoken about, but yes. So, but the idea is that somehow Lakshman put this circle around her line and basically said, stay inside of that and you'll be protected. So when Ravan came, she was inside of this, so she was protected, but eventually was encouraging her to step out. But of course, it's described the way he was speaking to her. He's supposed to be a mendicant. He's meant to be a brahmachari, but he was saying, oh, beautiful lady. You're so lovely. I can tell by looking into your eyes. You have a beautiful heart. And she was thinking, why is a mendicant speaking to me like this? So she was suspicious, but he was very convincing. And he eventually encouraged her to step forward. And at that point, he... took hold of her and kidnapped her, basically, took her back to his vehicle. What was his vehicle called? Ferrari? Mercedes? Huh?
Pushback. Push. Well, he had different ones. The one that he was flying into the forest was a chariot with demon-faced mules.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But that was the
Pushback. Yeah, it's good. That's a good point, because they're often, it is referred to as the Pushback Vimana. But it was the chariot with the, what was it?
Demon-faced mules,
yes.
What's
that?
About eight of them.
Eight. So if a man comes to you with a chariot with some demon-faced mules, it might be better. Ladies, don't get on the chariot, okay? Stay away. Anyway, never mind. So, yeah, like that. So anyway, He kidnaps her, and then that's the beginning of the end of the story. We're going a little bit in reverse. Everyone knows who is Vedavati?
Yeah.
No one knows who's Vedavati?
Yeah. Hmm? That's not a proper representation of the Cheshire dreadlocks.
I think that's what she's doing with her hand. Yeah, she's starting to dread it up. See, I think that's the origin of dreadlocks, because she saw Robin and she was in dread, so then she printed up her dreadlocks. So, who is Vedavati? Well, so it's described after Robin was given his benediction from Brahma, then he basically started to terrorize everyone, right? So you can imagine, if you're given the benediction that no one can kill you, then you just start to use that benediction. So he's flying around, going all over the place with his Rakshasa brothers, and just mainly attacking different demigods. And he goes to Kuvera, because he sees Kuvera is flying around on the Pushpak Vimana. So on this flying... similar to what King Chitraketu created later, but very opulent, golden palaces and jewels and so many things. So he...
Topuri.
And?
Topuri.
What is it?
Topuri. Topuri is like sculpted bushes.
Okay.
And in the shapes of some the different animals.
Okay, so topuri, sculpted bushes in the shapes of many different animals. Thank you, that's a very important point. So anyway, that's when Robin managed to get hold of the Pushpak Vimana. But then as he was flying around on this, then he looked down and he saw this hermitage of this sage, and sitting outside on a deerskin performing austerities and meditation was this very, very beautiful woman. And of course, this was the beginning of Robin's unleashed lust. And so he told everyone else, "You stay back, I'm going to approach her myself." So he approached this woman. And her name was Vedavati. And she was considered the personification of the Vedas and also an incarnation of Lakshmi Devi. And she was the daughter of a Brahma Rishi named Kushadwaj, who was the son of Kavi. God, that's so, I'm so happy. Right. Okay. No. Who? No. Bharadwaj. No. The guru of the demigods, Brihaspati. So she was basically the kind of granddaughter of Brihaspati, and she was performing this austerity because she had taken a vow that she would marry no one except for
Vishnu.
So she said, "No, I will marry no one except for Vishnu." So she just performed austerity and that was it. But she had been meditating for thousands of years, but still she was young and fresh, just like a demigoddess. So then Ravan set his sights on her. Look at her. So he approached her and tried to encourage her to come with him. At first he was kind of polite, trying to be charming. I think at this point he didn't actually disguise himself, he just went there with his 10 heads. So again, ladies, anyone approaches you with 10 heads, might be a good idea to kind of avoid them. And she just said no, and then she said, "I'm sorry, I cannot be with you." She was very congenial, very polite. "I'm sorry, dear sir, I cannot be with you because I have pledged myself and vowed myself to only be the wife of Vishnu. So therefore, I'm sorry, I cannot be with you." And he said, "Vishnu, he is my sworn enemy. You speak the name of Vishnu." And then he started to deride Vishnu. And at this point, she didn't become very happy. So she immediately started to chastise him. Ravan was like, "Whoa, ladies don't chastise me." But he thought, "I like her, she's got a bit of fire. She'll do well in my kind of harem, You know, so I'm taking, and he reached down and he grabbed her to take her back. And immediately she pulled herself away and she said, you know, you've defiled me by touching me, and you've spoiled me, because in those days, of course, if, you know, what was the pastime when, who is it that reaches into the well and touches Deva? Devayani, I think it was Devayani that was, yeah, she was the one that was in the well.
In this, like, it's, she's holding her hair, because what he actually did was he reached out and grabbed her by her hair.
By her locks, yeah, that's
and
right.
She changed her hand into a knife, and then she went, whooshing, she slashed it, and then he's left with this big piece of hair in his hand.
But sure.
And then there was that, so that's why she's...
Oh, okay, yeah, you can see here.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right there. Hair, hand of hair, yes. Very nice, thank you, Prabhu. So... In this way, then she basically stepped back and she cursed him. And she said, because you've defiled me, because you've touched me, then I'm going to come back. I'm going to kill myself now. But I'm going to come back and I'll be born from the earth and I will be your undoing. I will be the destruction of your entire kingdom. And then she basically stepped back and invoked fire from within herself and just burst into flames. That was it. Correct?
Yes.
Very sad. Yeah, it was very sad. But she basically cursed him, and in that way, she came back as Sita. And Sita, because Sita was born from the...
Janak.
She wasn't born from Janak. She was born from the earth. They were plowing the earth. And she came, when they were plowing the earth, she just came out
sprouted.
Of the earth. I don't know if sprouted is the right word. But she appeared. She's Lakshmi, for God's sake. It was a divine manifestation, but she was born of the earth. Sita. I think Sita means that, right? Born of the earth. Or... I don't think so. But I could do wrong. What is it? That's Shitas. Shita. So if you say Sita, and
stone. I guess.
Huh?
I think Sita means stone.
You guess Sita means stone. Okay. Anyways, she was born from the earth, whatever her name means. When they were plowing the earth, she came out. So like that. So this is the origin of Sita, and of course Sita then goes on to be the undoing of Ravan's entire kingdom.
Dynasty,
thank you. Dynasty.
Oh, you're in England. I don't understand.
But I'm an American, so I say dynasty if I like. So, from her entire dynasty. And his entire dynasty. And also she married... Ram. But who's Ram? She is...
Vishnu.
So she would only marry Vishnu, and she did marry Vishnu, so like that.
She was Lakshmi.
She was Lakshmi, yes. Yes, she was Lakshmi. But she took the form of the personification of the Vedas, because she was born of the austerities. Described, she's like the fruit of the bhakti of, what's his name, Bharad? Kushidwaj. So like that. Any questions, comments at this point? Anything?
What would this Vibhisha mean?
Not sure. Yeah, I'm not sure. Anyone else? Vibhisha means? Can look it up. Google. Anything else? Any other thoughts?
Defeated Yamaraj. Mm-hmm. They actually pinned him down at one point. They pierced him to the spot. It was like a pig surrounded by ants.
And yeah,
yeah, I could. So yeah, depending to the spot, you know, because he was trying to find the ultimate opponent, you know, because he clashed everybody, you know, all the kings of Ayodhya, you know, and it even challenged Shiva as well, and had all of his arms trapped under the Mount Kailash, you know, for 100 celestial years, and that's how he became a disciple of Shiva. But then eventually went to hell to challenge Yamaraj, and all the Yamadutas, they attacked his Pushpaka chariot, and they destroyed like all the garlands, and they went into the actual parks as well, and destroyed all the crystalline rivers, and the topiary as well. That was very nice. Big mistake, you know, it's like Ravana, he actually used the weapon that was given to him by Shiva, the Pashupata, and fired it into the floor, and hit the floor and turned everything to lava, you know, and all of these Yamadutas were wiped out, you know, and then he was laughing, you know. But then, like, Yamaraj himself came, you know, and he began, like, whirling, like, this mace, you know. And Yamaraj had, like, the death on one side of him, and, like, the time spirit on the other, and he started, like, whirling, and he got, like, red hot, and he got, like, white hot, and he's going to fling it at him. Rather than then, Brahma shows up and says, don't.
So Lord Brahma showed up and said, don't kill him.
Yeah.
Why was that?
Well, because he had to actually, didn't take part in Ravana's leela.
Yeah, he had to be killed by it. Because who was Ravan? Yeah, it was Jai. I think he was Jai. It's Jai. Because he's the oldest, right? Ravan is the oldest. I think it's Jai. Jai is always the oldest one. Jai and Vijay. Yeah, so he's Jai from the spiritual world. So he came specifically, and he had already been promised by the Lord that he would only be killed by?
Human.
No, by himself. The Lord would come and kill him. He would come and do battle with him, so like that. Nice. Should make a movie.
Maybe already have.
Movies or dramas?
Movies. One of them was here in England at the college. You saw it. It was like the Ballad Kingdom.
Oh, okay.
With the kids, you know, from.
Oh, that, yeah. You said, what did you say, the college? That was like the school, the Gurukul.
Yeah, the Gurukul, yeah.
That's slightly different from a college. Yeah. Okay. So, anyone else? Yes, Prabhu.
Sita means furrow.
Furrow, yeah. Yeah, furrow, yeah. Yes, not stone.
No.
Yeah. Sheila means stone.
Sheila.
So if you meet a girl named Sheila. Hi, Sheila. So, a lot of this pastime seems to revolve around lust. Driven by lust, the strong desire to enjoy lust, the strong desire to enjoy or exploit something or someone for our own pleasure. Very powerful. The all-devouring sinful enemy, right? What's the verse? Verses right on the tip of your tongue. So, what's the Sanskrit? Anyone knows the Sanskrit? All the bowing enemy?
Is lust only what you should contact with the two of the passion. A later transfer will form into wrath, which is all derailed sinful anger as well.
Yeah.
You didn't say anything. I couldn't understand what you were doing. He said it so eloquently. It was just destiny from early group to recite.
Vaishnava is difficult to understand.
Yeah, so in one sense we can see that this this principle is permeates the entire Ramayana pastime. From the conversation between Mantara and Kaikeyi, she's motivated by lust, maybe not the same lust that we might say to enjoy with another man or woman, but this principle to enjoy the property of God. You know, as Prabhupada said, they want the kingdom of God without God. Yeah, they want the kingdom of Ram without Ram. So Mantara wanted Ayodhya, but she didn't want Ram in the picture. And she convinced Kaikeyi, and then Kaikeyi became overwhelmed and overcome by the same lust. So lust is also contagious. So you can see that the whole material world is basically going on by this profound enemy in the form of lust. And in the end, this killing of Ravan by Ram is the conquering over of lust. So that's a whole pastime in and of itself. Usually we try to tell that pastime on what's the festival? The killing of Ravan?
Ram Vijaya.
Ram Vijaya, yeah? Dussehra, I think it is, right? Sometimes it's pronounced Dussehra, but I think it's Dussehra. Dussehra. So the killing of Lord Ram. It's nice at the manor they used to build the big Ram Murti and fire an arrow into it and burn it.
Yeah, but they used to do that in Sri Lanka, but I think the government tried to stop them.
And they fired an arrow into the government.
No, into Ravan, because like in Sri Lanka, Ravan's like the worshipable
deity. Oh, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. So it's like sacrilege, you know? Also, like, there's some commentaries that were saying that, like, Ravan was... There's three brothers, right? There's Vibhishan, Ravan, and...
Kumbhakarna.
But they're all, like, personified modes, you know? Like, Kumbhakarna, because he would sleep, like, 6 months a year and drink wine when he woke up. Mode of ignorance. And then Ravan is personification and mode of passion, you know? I think even I had one of his heads was only for carnal delights, you know? It was only for enjoyment, you know. That was like one of his heads was specifically meditating on that all the time, and then Vibhishan, Lord of Buddhas. You know?
Mm. Nice point. What's that?
One whole head meditating.
You have only got one head, and that's all that meditates on. So my first question this morning was, what time's the feast? You know? So I'm always thinking of the delights of the tongue, yes, how to enjoy. So yes, so this conquering of lust, and we can see that how when we're overcome by lust in some sense, whether it's powerful or weak, then we have the propensity to not be able to hear from others, and this was also a big problem for Ravan, repeatedly not being able to hear from those who are giving good advice, and even declaring them to be his enemies. Even his own brother, he declared to be his enemy. And so it becomes very difficult when this contamination runs a wreck in our life, then we can be really, really overwhelmed and overcome, and it's a tragedy. And unfortunately, this is the all-devouring sinful enemy of us in this world, and we become covered by this lust and life, and we need to somehow or other conquer over it. So, what is the verse? Evam buddhe param buddhva samsabhyatmanamapana jahishatram mahabaho kama rupam durasidam. Yes, that's the verse. So, how's the translation go?
Knowing oneself to be transcendental.
spiritual intelligence, Krishna consciousness, the insatiable enemy. Kama rupam durasadam, this insatiable enemy, this. Yes, so we have to cultivate sincere Krishna consciousness, and that will lead us to victory in spiritual life, and where we can actually conquer this. In order to do that, also with this last scene, and Ram, he gets the, what's it called, the Anantaridai? Is that the name of the arrow? Anantaridai, I think that's the name of the arrow. It's a special arrow, and it's given to him by his spiritual master, right? Yeah. And he explains that you have to fire this, because he was fighting. They were fighting for ages, and he kept hacking off his heads. But then as soon as he would hack off one head, then it would just grow back. I think at one point it's described that even one head would grow back as like 10 more heads. And he was actually getting more ferocious the more that Ram was trying to defeat him. And it can be like that sometimes, right? You try to defeat lust, and it just keeps, you know, getting bigger and bigger and bigger. But yeah, it's the Anantaridai, I think it's called. So you have to fire this arrow straight into the heart. And I think the Acharyas described that this means that basically we have to follow the orders of the spiritual master. And by strictly following the orders of the spiritual master, then we can conquer over. Because I think Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains, who is it that represents lust amongst the demons? Your Guru Maharaj talks about it all the time, right? Different demons. It's one of the ones that Lord Balaram kills. It's Palambasura. Palambasura represents lust. And it's described there by Bhaktivinoda Thakur and the Acharyas, and of course Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj describes very nicely that actually it's Balaram who kills Palambasura. It's by the power of the spiritual master, by the strict adherence and following of the orders of the spiritual master, that lust can be conquered. We can't do it on our own. Whereas all many of the other demons, one other demon was killed by Balaram. It was Dhenukasura. Was it Dhenukasura then? He represents lust. No, his ass-like mentality. Yeah, I got that too. Sorry. I've got a chariot drawn by 8 asses with demon faces. That's this body. Yeah, wonderful. Yeah, so like that. So by the mercy of the spiritual master. And then we can return to Ayodhya. Back to the spiritual world. Hari Bol. Shri Ram Nami Mahamahotsav Ki. So we can read this verse again, just one more time as a conclusion, and actually we'll read both of them. So this is Lord Chaitanya speaking first. So please repeat. One is immediately freed.
From the clutches of Maya.
If he seriously
and
sincerely says,
my dear Lord,
although I have forgotten you for so many long years in this material world, today I am surrendering unto you. I am your sincere and serious servant. Please engage me in your service.
It is my vow.
So this is Lord Ram speaking. That if one only,
one seriously surrenders unto me,
saying,
my dear Lord,
from this day, I am yours,
and praise to me
for courage. I shall immediately award courage.
I shall immediately award courage
to that person.
To that person.
And he will always.
And he will always
remain safe.
Remain safe
from that time on.
From that time on.
Jai Shri Ram Chandra Bhagavan Ki.
Jai.
Hare Krishna. So, any closing reflection? Last thought? Anything? Anything? Okay. Everyone's achieved Zen. Yes.
Yeah.
Always got that the last word on your Gabby.
Yeah. No, it was just a point that you missed of the Jharkhand forest. No, not
Jharkhand forest.
Afghanistan. The outpost of the Rakshasas when he was fighting against Kaur. So you cut that short, but. What went down actually was he sent Sita Lakshman into the cave, and then he put on his armor, and then he saw the Rakshasa army approaching, flanking with the pageantry of war, and he gave them the warning, you know, as Kshatriya ethics, he gave them the warning, he said, leave, there's 14,000 of them, you know, and on the way there, they got all these terrible omens, you know, the horses were kind of skittering around, even though it was flat ground, you know. And he got this buzzing in his head, and he's sort of like inauspicious omens everywhere. But they still kept marching on, you know, brave Rakshasas, you know? And so then, you know, there's a little bit of kind of talk, and then the demigods actually surrounded in the clouds, and they brought all the drums and tambourines and whatnot to kind of, you know.
Tambourines, yeah.
Well, whatever they got, you know, bugles, conches, kettle drums.
Anaka Dundubis.
I think Anaka is the one who plays. I think it's the name of.
It's also the name of Nanda Maharaj.
Nanda Maharaj, yeah, Anaka Dundubis. Yeah. But yeah, all of that, you know, paraphernalia. And they were looking down, and it was like Ramachandra was like dark storm clouds surrounding the sun, which isn't appropriate because Ram was sun of dynasty. And then it all kicked off, you know, and like Ramachandra, he said that he bent his bow like to a perfect circle, and there was arrows flying out in all directions like rays of the sun at the speed of light, cutting down elephants, chariots, foot soldiers, everything. He decimated, they all came charging like an ocean, and afterwards it was like so many battered crops after a storm, the storm of the violence of like Lord Ramachandra. It was like Trishiras had both of his arms cut off, and he collapsed spitting blood out his three heads, and then Dushan was next to go, and like Kaur tried to rally some of the troops, and like do a second attack, you know, which was completely decimated. And then he stood alone before Lord Ramachandra, and Ramachandra was like, you know, so okay, now we'll fight. And he said, you know, you're just, you know, he said your head. Ramachandra was, you know, the speech of the Kshatriya was like, your head shall roll on the floor like a ripened fruit, you know, falling from a tree. And Kaur was like, you know, your words are like burning straw. They've flared up with very little heat or light, you know. You've shown that you can boast, but now let's see if you can fight, you know. Mm. And then he led towards Ramachandra with his mace, and he was screaming, but Ramachandra just took one step back, and he pulled back his bow, and it was a lightning bolt weapon, and it hit Kaur in the chest with the sound of a thunderclap and cut a hole through him. No, and that was the massacre, and it was over in like, I don't know, 10 minutes or something. 14,000 soldiers, you know, the Chamstan outpost.
Shri Ram Chandra Bhagavan Ki. So that's, I could never have done that. Gabby Carter, Pokemon King. Okay. Okay, so there's one more part to the talk today. Everyone is. Up for it. This is the only time you'll be asked to use your mobile phones during class. Everyone has their mobile phone, and if you don't have it, then no problem. You don't get to play. So, we're going to play a little game. Anyone has ever played? You played before, and you played online. So, let's see. What's that?
Browser history.
That's You might become Krishna conscious then. But we should check your browser history, I think. You want to talk about checking browser history? So we'll do that after class, shall we? Everybody bring your phones and mobile devices to the temple. Remember we did that rarely 4 months before?